Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Chef Tom, and I'm coming to you live from the Hackney School of Food. We have a lovely lesson to go through with you this afternoon, and we have got our bits and pieces all set up, ready to go. I hope, I'm going to tell you this right at the start, I hope you have got your ovens on. They need to be preheating. If you haven't done it yet, pop over to the oven, turn it on 180 degrees C, gas mark 4, just so that's nice and warm for us so we can cook our lovely breads later on. We have a fantastic selection of things, so just to go through what you should have in front of you, I'm going to show and tell to the camera. We've got some wholemeal flour, if you're using gluten-free, anything of your favourite ones, or plain white flour works as well. I particularly love making this with spelt, it's really tasty. We've got some buttermilk, really delicious, sour sort of taste. Again, if you can't get hold of this, a thin yogurt, or even just, you know, using water or milk is really good. It's your liquid for this. We also have two things, baking powder, which is going to give you your lift and your rise in your bread, and salt, which is going to give us some flavour, some seasoning. And an optional extra, but one that I always put into my soda breads, is this lovely selection of seeds. Today I've gone with pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, and a nice handful of oats in there as well. Oats give you a nice, really good flavour, but also help keep it nice and moist. So that's your basic stuff for a soda bread. But what we're doing today is we're going to pack it full of lovely vitamins from our vegetables. Now, I hope you've chosen some of your own at home. For me, I've got a selection here on my plate over here. I'm probably going to go with parsnip because it's going to give you a really lovely extra flavour. But you can go carrots or beetroot if you want a particularly bright pink one. Sweet potato, celeriac is going to be an interesting flavour. Or even swedes. You know, the root vegetables here are just giving extra flavour. And we're also giving some extra lovely vitamins and nutritions. For those of you who want to do something while we're baking, I'm also going to show you how to make some stuff to go with it. We've got a little tub of double cream. And double cream is really important because it's the fat that's going to turn into butter. It's room temperature. So again, if you don't have this out of the fridge just yet, take it out now. It'll be warming up while we're working. And you can see I filled it up, not all the way. We need some room for it to shake around. A good solid lid. Okay, I've got a clip lid on mine, but a good solid lid for shaking later on. The other thing I'm going to show you is if you haven't been able to get hold of buttermilk yourself and you've got some whole milk in the fridge that, you know, is maybe not going to be great to drink or put in a cup of tea, then you can use this. This is great. Whole milk here and just half a lemon is all you need, okay? If you don't have a lemon, a little bit of vinegar, something that's not going to give any colour. So we're using cider vinegar, white wine vinegar, not your chip shop vinegar or your red wine vinegars, anything like that, because that's going to make it go a bit of a strange colour. I'm going to put those to the side. We're going to come back to that later. But I hope you've all got your ingredients ready. We've got our dry ingredients. We've got our wet ingredients. It's a really simple, lovely recipe. In terms of equipment you need to use today as well, I've got a mixing bowl and a fork, some weighing scales. But if you don't have that, what we're doing is your ratio is about 3 parts to 5 parts of your buttermilk to flour. So if you're saying you put 2 cups, this is my maths, okay? Hopefully I won't be judged too much on this. But if you're doing 3 cups of buttermilk, you'll need 5 cups of wholemeal. You know, this is a really simple recipe that is very much by eye. It's been made, you know, hundreds of years. I would call this Irish brown bread. There's plenty of other countries around the world who use this sort of thing. Do it by eye. Some of my baking friends might tell me off by telling you that. But this is a really simple recipe, guys. I want you to feel confident and happy in making it. Giving yourself a bit of space to work in is always good. So I'm just going to clear some room. And then we're also going to need a grater to grate our vegetables. So once we've got all our bits and pieces ready together, you'll also need something to mix with. Either your hand is a really good tool. I'm going to use a fork today and maybe a butter knife or a fairly blunt sort of thing to cut across into our dough later on. Or if you've got one of these fancy dough scrapers like me, we can use that as well. That's what we're doing today. I'm going to give you a little bit of a chat about what we're up to here, just in case you haven't got anything and you just need to settle yourself in. Our ingredients I've put just at the top of our chat. I've got the lovely Danielle looking after us today in the chat room. If you have any questions, I'm going to try and look at them as I'm going. It's quite hard to type, talk, and cook at the same time. So Danielle will try and answer any questions. If not, if I miss any, we'll put them on our Instagram feed and you'll be able to catch up. And if you miss anything today, guys, you think I'm going slightly too fast, we're going to be putting this video on YouTube afterwards. So you can rewatch in your own leisure. And you know, you can take your time, enjoy yourself, have a cup of tea while we're doing it. So a little bit about the School of Food. The Hackney School of Food was opened in March last year, and we're a collaboration between Chefs and Schools, the charity that's aiming to improve school food, revolutionising meals from scratch, nutritious and tasty. We're upskilling their workers. We're using head chefs who have come from the restaurant industry and putting them into schools to create really great food for our kids. They're also educating our staff, our kids, our families, our communities in what makes food great and tasty. We're working in collaboration with the Leap Federation, and that's a federation of three schools in Hackney. We're actually based on one of the sites here at Mandeville Primary School in Clapton. We've got a lovely view of our gardens. Unfortunately, you can't see them today. Hopefully, you'll be able to come and see us one day in the future, guys. After this is all over, we'll have lovely events going on. We've got a massive garden. We've got a lovely kitchen for you to cook in. We'll run lessons for you to enjoy and come. We will cook anything from a Thai green curry, which I do with our year fives, to the soda bread, actually a variant of this we teach with our year threes. So lots of lovely things to come and enjoy and experience. For the meantime, guys, every Wednesday at 4 o'clock, we're going to be coming here live on our website, Hackney School of Food, or on our YouTube channel, the Chefs and Schools YouTube channel, where you'll have me to put up with every Wednesday, but we'll be teaching loads of different things, guys. So stay tuned. Our recipes for each week will be going out up onto the website. So please come on, see what you can cook. It's really simple, guys. This School of Food is for everyone. It's for children, it's for adults, it's for people who sort of know how to cook but want to improve their skills, who know nothing and want to learn something new. Food is a passion of mine, as you can probably tell if you spend some time with us over the next few weeks. I love eating it, I love making it, I love tasting it, I love eating it. I'm not sure if I mentioned that one already, but it's a really fun thing for me to do. And I want to share that love with you over the next few weeks by sharing you some simple recipes that are delicious, hopefully simple for you to make. And if you have any questions, as I say, you can put them in our chat box. Danielle will try and answer them. I'll try and keep an eye on them as well. But that's a little bit about us. Okay, the Hackney School of Food. Hopefully you'll enjoy this size, guys. We're going to get started very shortly. A very quick rundown again for you, just as we're going to set up, is that you've got 500 grams of wholemeal flour, 300 mils of buttermilk. We're going to be using a teaspoon of salt, 2 teaspoons of baking powder, a handful of seeds is an optional extra, and I'm going today use a parsnip, but you can use a medium size beetroot or carrots or any kind of root vegetable that's going to give you a nice flavour as well. So that's our ratio. At this point, I do just say put your thumbs up or tell me when you're ready to go, but I'm going to assume you're all with me, and let's get started our baking. Okay, so coming over to my mixing bowl, I'm going to start by adding in 500 grams of our wholemeal flour. Now, this is a really simple recipe. So wholemeal flour or plain flour, spelt flour, your gluten-free flour of choice, whichever you're using today, gang. This is a bread that is not reliant on having lots and lots of gluten, okay? Our big chef thing at of lockdown, everyone got involved and was trying to make sourdough. You need lots of gluten with strong flour for this. This one isn't like that. This is a simple, very quick recipe, okay? We're going to have a little well in the middle, okay? Now, if you've got self-raising flour, you can absolutely use this in this recipe. I would just take, instead of using 2 spoonfuls of baking powder in it, just drop it down to 1, because you've already, the self-raising already has baking powder inside. But not enough for the lift that we need. So if you are using self-raising, just go to 1 teaspoon of baking powder. I'll remind you when we get to that. So I've made a little well in the middle of my flour, you can see here, just here. This is going to help me pour in my buttermilk and make sure it kind of stays where we want it to go. So I'm going to pour in 300 mils or 300 grams. Doesn't matter with this. You can weigh it or you can measure it however you like. All the way up. So we're doing five. If you're tearing it, it's another 300. If you're doing some sums, you're up to 800 now. So you can see just in the middle here, and you've got that lovely sort of things just starting to spread over the top. Now the sourness of our buttermilk is really key, because that's going to activate our baking powder. Our baking powder, as I say, is our rising agent. So in sourdoughs or normal breads, you're using yeast. And that's our friend, the bacteria, yeast. We're going to use this one. This is just a chemical reaction of the sourness. If you want to find out what a really cool way this, I love this, is like a mini volcano. Get a little bit of baking powder onto your teaspoon and squeeze a tiny bit of lemon juice on top, and you'll see all the bubbles. And that is basically what's happening inside our baking. So as it rises, it kind of captures into the dough. We're going to add in 1 teaspoon of salt. Okay. Now, teaspoons of salt can vary to being mountains of them to being very little. We want a level teaspoon. So what I tend to do is I put a spoon on it, and then give it a little shake. So then you're kind of leveled off. That's going in on top to give us some flavor. As I say, guys, we're going to add in seeds today. So what I do is a nice big spoonful, handful of those, right in the middle. And this is so simple. You're just chucking things in to the bowl as we work. Now, this is a very simple, easy soda bread. That is basically mixing it together and you're done. We're adding our special ingredient today. So whatever you've chosen to add into whichever vegetable you've chosen to add in, we're going to grate them now. Okay, so as I say, I'm going to use some parsnip. It's beautiful this time of year. Lots of it about, lots of different things, guys. So we need to use a grater. I'm going to use the larger hole on it because that's going to give me a nice texture inside. You can use the side bits, okay, if you want a smaller texture inside, whatever you want to use. But then, nice and easy, just going to grate away. This is the point where I usually make some sort of terrible pun about how great it is to see you all today. Hopefully we've got some laughs in your kitchens out there. We're just grating it away. Now, some of you might be questioning why I've not taken the skin off of the parsnip. Actually, if you give it a good wash, the parsnip skin is actually quite good for you. There's more nutrients in it. Same with most root vegetables. There are some things that I potentially wouldn't use the skin on, maybe swede and celeriac. But things like carrots and stuff, use the skins, guys, unless they're a little bit tired looking. There we go. So I've grated mine away. You can see this lovely pile here. Now, give it a good shake, making sure you get all those bits out. And then we're going to take it back over to our mixing bowl. And hopefully you guys have gone down to a good size mixing bowl, and we're not going to just have everything pour over the top. So at this point, I can get rid of my weighing scales. And then we're going to pour it in on top. So you can see, everything's in one bowl. Easier on the washing up as well then. And then what we do is just going to use that fork, or if you're feeling messy, you're feeling like you want to have some fun. My motto in the kitchen is, the more mess you make, the more fun you have. And that's usually because I'm doing most of the tidying up. But here we go, guys. You're doing that lovely, just getting that right underneath. So in order to try and make everything stay in the bowl, you're going underneath and you're sort of folding it over the top. Underneath, folding it over the top. And you'll notice that as you start off doing this, the dough looks really crumbly, and you might be tempted to add a bit more buttermilk or just grab some water at the moment. We can do, but we need to just pause for a second because there's going to be moisture inside our root vegetable. And depending on what you're using, so parsnips tend to be quite dry, carrots tend to be a bit wetter, and you've got a variant in between. What we need to do is, once you've got everything together like this, it's kind of crumbly, you're then squeezing it together. So this is where the bit where we use our hands, okay? You see, I'm just giving it a good squeeze, a good squeeze, a good squeeze, and then I'm going to pour that onto the side. Now, at the moment, it does look quite crumbly. What I'm going to try and do here is, as I squeeze everything together, you'll find there are bits that do fall off. Okay, now we can push this to the side, or even better, what we can do So if there's a little bit of glass, a little glass of water to the side, we can just pour a tiny bit inside, probably 1 to 2 tablespoons. Okay. Now, this is entirely dependent on what's happening with your root vegetables. Okay. So some of you may need to add this, some of you may not. But you're looking for something. If it's too sticky, definitely don't add any. If it's really crumbly and you think, actually, this is not going to stay together, then at this point, you can add it. And you can see what I'm doing here is I'm just folding it, and I'm pushing it together, folding it, pushing it together. If it is a sticky dough, which tends not to happen with our soda bread, because as you can see, I've got some dry bits on the side here. If it is sticky, just stop and pause. Have some flour on your hands, and then you're going to wash your hands in flour, okay? A little bit more if it is too sticky. Not too much, because you don't want to make that bread too dry. And then we're going back to it. Now, as you're pushing it together, you're also beginning to knead. As I said earlier, we don't necessarily need a lot of gluten in this, so we won't be here for a long time. We're basically just making sure that we're getting shape, we're getting things mixed together really well, and we're just beginning to form that little bit of gluten that's in our wholemeal flour, like this. Now, for those of you using gluten-free flour, this might be a little stickier at the moment, okay? So you're gonna add a little bit more if you need to, because you don't need to knead your bread. Soda bread, as I say, doesn't need that much gluten. So we don't need to worry about things like xanthan gum if you're using it. We're just going to mix it together, okay? And you should end up with a little ball like this. Mine's actually quite large. Now this, this ball, you can bake like that. That's going to take 30, 40 minutes in your oven. And actually, I prefer a dough that's a bit smaller. It's take a bit quicker to cook as well. So that means I get to eat my bread quicker. So what I'm doing is using a butter knife or a table knife just to cut it in half, and then cut it in half again. So we then have 4 doughs. And then we're just going to give that back into our hands. We're going to either roll it around like this, or you can shape it on the side, give it a little twist, like so, give it a little push down, give it a little twist. 2 different ways there, guys. Some people prefer doing it in their hands, some people prefer doing the little twist. Again, if your hands are sticky, just stop, have a little bit of flour on top, and there we go. So, I have 1. And you'll see, guys, that it's not quite a ball. What I've done is I've flattened it, because what's gonna happen is I'm gonna cut a little cross in the top. And this does 2 things. 1, it makes it look nice, okay? We have this nice, lovely way of looking at it. And as I cut into it, I'm not cutting all the way down. Okay, you can see, I've just cut about halfway down. The second thing this is doing is it's giving us a chance to let the air, the bubbles that are created by the buttermilk and the baking powder working together, a little chance to escape. So what it's going to do is, as it puffs up, it's going to spread out kind of like that, and it's going to look beautiful. So that's 1. Just putting it over onto my baking tray. And do that again. So you can do the baker's roll, which is letting it slightly stick on the side and just rolling it around with your fingers. Kind of, you're doing this, kind of like a squeeze but twist at the same time, like that. Slow it down for you. There you go. Okay, again, you're going to pop it on some parchment paper. If you have a non-stick baking tray, this is perfect. This, you can just pop it on the non-stick baking tray. You don't have to worry about the parchment paper. That's all okay like this, okay? There we go, 2. Another way for you to create a really lovely looking dough is by pouring a little bit of your mixed seeds onto the side, and then as you do that, you then press into it like so, exactly what you were doing earlier with that shaping round like this. And then what that does is, as it bakes, all these seeds and these bits of porridge oats, they crisp up on the outside and deliver a really lovely toasty flavor on the outside as you bite into it. And we give it a little cut. You can see, nice and easy, doesn't need anything that sharp. A palette knife will do in a pinch, as I've done many times before in my baking. I'm just going to show you that little trick again with the seeds on the outside. I'd love to know in the comments what sort of seeds you guys are using today, or what vegetables you've chosen. Mine, pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, and porridge oats, and I've gone for parsnip. I did this lesson in the summertime with some children, and we all got to choose one of them, and the best one that was the most impressive by the vote was the one that had beetroot inside, because it was just a beautiful bright pink colour. And particularly this time of year, we've got lots of lovely root vegetables coming out in season. But there we go, guys. Any more bits you can just sprinkle on top. And that is our soda bread. Nice and easy. At this point, guys, you might want to give your area a little bit of a tidy. So anything that's kind of fallen into a pie like this, what I do is I use my bowl, my mixing bowl, I bring it back into a big pile, and then just scoop off the sides into my bowl, and that makes life a little bit easier for us later on. Everything then goes over to the wash up area, and that, I'll show you my tray of all four now, that is how quick and how simple it is to make some lovely doughs, okay? This, as I say, I hope you've all remembered that your oven is on 180 degrees, gas mark 4. There we go, that's my doughs, 1, 2, 3, 4. And we're gonna bake this now. So, as I say, this shouldn't take as long because there's four smaller ones. 15, 20 minutes probably at the maximum. You'll see a golden kind of crust. You'll see them beginning to puff up. They're gonna pop in the oven now. If you have a chance, have a slurp of tea once it goes into the oven. Give your hands a little wash. Next thing we're going to do after this is we're going to start making, I'm going to show you how to make our buttermilk. So whole milk that's warm and half a lemon juice or some vinegar. Okay, into the oven we go. Remember to set your timers. And I would always start at the lower end of your scale. So if you've got 15 to 20, set your timer for 15 to begin with. And that means that you're not going to overcook it. Overcooked bread, it takes a long time to burn bread, but overcooked bread can be quite dry. So, as I said, the next thing we're going to do is our buttermilk. So just having a quick tidy. Although I did say that There we go. So, the more fun you have, the more mess you're making. In the kitchen, there is obviously no play time without tidy up time. Cleaning as you go means that you're a happy chef. It means you're not getting yourself tumbled over your previous work. And actually, it's the way that chefs are trained to work. So we work tidily, we clear away as we go, we then move on to the next one. And I think being a tidy chef will means that you will have a tidy kitchen, which means you'll have a tidy recipe, and hopefully you'll have some fun. I hope we're having fun out there today. So, the next thing we're going to do, I'm going to show you how to make our buttermilk. Okay? So this is something that if you can't get a hold of buttermilk or thin yogurt to make our bread, if you've got some milk, this is basically how one of the ways how we used to make, this is a cheat buttermilk, okay? So we've got milk that's either slightly sour on the turn maybe, or at least definitely this needs to be warm. And then I'm gonna squeeze in my lemon juice. So we squeeze in the lemon juice. Now you want to be careful that we don't put any pips in. So I find the easiest way of doing that is to basically make a little kind of catch with your hand underneath. So that as we do this, as we squeeze in, the juice will come through your hand, like that. But then, as you give it a little shake, make sure it's nice and tight, the seeds then end up in your hand, and then that can go into your bin. All we need now to do is to give that a little mix, and you'll notice that things start happening almost straight away with the with the milk. It begins to curdle on top. And basically what's happening is the lemon juice, the acid in the lemon juice, is just breaking down the milk. And you can see it becomes to look a little lumpy. We'll come back to that later on. That just needs to sit in a warm place. Take the spoon out because we want to make sure it works easily and doesn't get interrupted. So that, very quick, very simple way of making buttermilk. If you can't get hold of the stuff from the shops, can't get hold of thin yogurt, and it's also a great way of, if you've got milk that's on the turn, it's a way of using up without throwing away. Now, this is actually, the next thing I'm going to show you is actually where we used to get our buttermilk from. I've got here a jar, half full, roughly half full, of double cream. It's about here. Now this has been out of the fridge, so it's nice and warm, and this is going to make your life a lot easier. Now, this bit, you're going to have to start shaking, okay? So we're shaking, you're going to work up a little bit of a sweat, you're going to earn that piece of bread later on. And basically what we're doing, by shaking it, nice and simple, making sure that lid stays on, okay? If you're using a jam jar, keep that tight. If you're a bit worried about it, something that I used to do is put a tea towel on top and bottom, so if it does accidentally split, you're not going to send cream all over your kitchen. So when we're shaking it like this, like that, what's happening is you're actually whipping the cream. So actually, if you stopped now, you would have this really nice, thick, luxurious cream. I'm going to show you what it looks like. It's always good to stop and kind of see how other people are working. So mine looks really thick like that at the moment. We still have a way to go. We're turning this into butter. So on the lid goes again, and we give it another good shake. Okay, and you can see, whew, doing a lot of exercise. You'll begin to hear it kind of hitting the top and bottom. I'm just going to pause very quickly here, because you'll then be able to see, if you look inside, the fat and this liquid. Okay, that liquid, that is actually buttermilk. Okay, this is originally where buttermilk comes from. I'm going to shake it a little bit more so it gets nice and solid. And the colder your cream is, the longer this is going to take you to do. Okay, so give it a good shake. Hopefully you're not covering your kitchen in double cream at the moment. But if we open it up, again, you'll be able to see that that's nice and thick. We've got that liquid around the outside. So at the moment, we have butter and we have buttermilk. At this point, I'm just going to grab a bowl. This bit is the messy bit in this stage. What I want to do is get your hands in here and just pick up the butter. Okay, so it's not quite ready yet. So all we need to do is we're going to give it a squeeze. Okay, give it a squeeze. And you'll feel, you should notice if you're doing this at home, that the juice is coming off. I'm just going to put that to one side. I'm going to go back in with my fingers just to make sure I've got everything here. There we go. Now this won't work with single cream because this is the fat. This is the double part of it, okay? This is how you've got your butter. Now this is lovely and soft and gooey, and I really like soft butter like this. In here, we've got our buttermilk. And if you were doing this before, we could add this now. If we were adding it to the buttermilk that we're creating, the cheats buttermilk, we would have enough probably for half a loaf of what we've just done, our recipe here, or at least what we've got here. So I've got my buttermilk that I've created, cheats buttermilk, and I've also got my buttermilk here. Now it is quite liquidy. If you leave to put that in the fridge, you've just kind of beaten all the fat out of it, but if you leave that in the fridge now, it will firm up a little bit, but it won't ever be the same as buttermilk that you buy in the shops, because that kind of goes through an extra process, and they do it in huge big vats, butter churns. Now, if you are wanting to do some baking, make some pastries, this is unsalted, making cakes, things like that. Really good, useful. But if you wanted to use this as your butter spread for maybe on maybe a freshly baked loaf of soda bread, then we're going to add a little bit of salt to it. That depends on how much butter you've made, but I would say this is about what I've got in my hands. That's probably about 100 grams, and that's come from about 140, 150 mils of double cream. So you're losing about 50 milliliters out of the 150 to your buttermilk, and you're left with 100 grams of solids. For that, I'm going to add in about half a teaspoon, a nice big chef-y kind of pinch. I'm going to add that on top. And there's also, if you want to add in some other flavors to this, so at the moment, this would be considered salted butter, okay? Now, you could add in dried oregano or some chopped onions. One of my favorite things of doing is slightly caramelizing some shallots and then putting them in. But I'm going to use today this lovely few herbs, okay? So I've got some chives here. And this is so simple as well, making this chive butter, which goes really well with our parsnip soda breads. What I'm going to do is I'm going to fold it in half, like so. And then I'm going to use a pair of scissors just to chop over like this. And this lovely chivey butter then becomes beautiful. Now, at the moment, this butter is really, really soft. Okay, remember our double cream was out of the fridge for a while, so it's nice and warm. Which means that this next bit, you can either do with your hands and make even more of a mess, or just use a spoon. And I actually prefer a spoon with this, because that what happens is then you can really squish it down and mix it together like that, making sure you don't end up with one kind of lump of chive in the middle. Here we go, guys. This now turns into a really delicious butter. If you leave this overnight, that flavor from all the salt and from the chives or whatever herbs you're putting into it, or roasted garlic maybe if you want to have some garlic that you put into the oven in a clove, roast it 180 for about 10 to 15 minutes, it goes nice and soft, then you can add that to your butter, and then you've got beautiful garlic butter. And again, you're shaping it with your hands, kind of rolling it like this. And there we are, okay? If you wrap that up in some parchment paper or put it into your jam jar once it's clean, or even just leave it in a bowl and put some cling film over the top, pop that in the fridge and that will firm up like a proper pack of butter. And that will probably last you, well, in the fridge, it will last a week or two. But if you're putting it on top of the bread, it may not last that long in a big family as well. Okay, so that's our chivey butter. I've got a few more minutes left on my oven. I can see I've got a really nice tall oven with a lovely clear glass, so I can look into it, and it's got a golden color. They've puffed up, they're beginning to separate out as well. But this is really important. Don't open those ovens of yours at home yet, okay? If you open the oven, all the hot air escapes, and the hot air is no longer in the oven to cook the bread. So what we need to do is just leave it. Be patient, okay? 10 minutes in, we should be fine. Be patient. Patience is a real virtue in a kitchen. If you are looking for things to do, there's always washing up, there's always cleaning to do in the kitchen. But now I'm going to jump back to my Cheats buttermilk. And you should see, if you're doing this at home, it becomes to look really... I suppose unappetizing. It's like when you pour slightly soured milk into a cup of tea or a cup of coffee and it starts to separate. That's what's going to happen, basically, in here. But if you look at my spoon, you'll see, if I drain off the bits, you'll begin to see little spots. And this is what's happening. The lime juice or the vinegar, whatever you're using, is beginning to coagulate and pull those bits together. And it's going to sour it. And remember what I said earlier, that the sourness of the buttermilk, the acidity, reacts with the baking powder to create the bubbles. So this is how we use that. So a yogurt which is slightly sour will work fantastically as well. That's been probably 10 minutes since I've done that. We could use it now. Or we can leave it, and again, if you leave it overnight, the flavor is going to develop even more, and you're going to get a really nice kind of sour edge to your soda breads. So, another 3 minutes. Remember, patience is a virtue, gang, okay? With our soda bread, I'm just going to recap what we've done. Just if you're following along at home, these are the bits that we should have already put in. So we've added our flour, our buttermilk, our salt, our baking powder, and our optional handful of seeds into our bowl. We've grated, for me, I did parsnips, but whatever root vegetable you wanted to choose at home, we grated that and added that in. Mixed everything together, kneaded it until it becomes a nice one ball. I have then divided it into four. So I now have four separate small little buns of soda bread, but if you want to keep it as a whole loaf, that's going to take an extra bit of time to cook, but will be really juicy and delicious and lovely. They've gone in the oven 180 degrees or gas mark 4. At the moment, they've been for nearly 15 minutes. We're going to check that in just a little bit. What I've done in the meantime is I've made my own butter, and we put some double cream into a jam jar, tightly fitting lid, and just shaking it. Warm double cream, shake it, shake it, shake it, until you get past the stage of whipped cream until you get nice solids. Squeeze out the butter like this, and then you're left with the juice for the buttermilk. The buttermilk that we created, the cheats buttermilk, is basically warm whole milk with a bit of acid in it, which today, as I've used lemon juice, but as I said, vinegar or something like that, a clear vinegar will be absolutely fine. Pop those in the fridge, guys. If you're baking, or keep it for the next time if you're baking. If you run out of soda bread tomorrow, then you know what you're doing. The recipe for this, as I say, is up on the website, and it will be there along with this video, which we'll put up on our YouTube channel, and we'll also put on a little section of the website, so that if you have missed a step or you've tuned in halfway through, you won't miss anything at all. Okay. Now, one more minute. So to avoid the glaring noise that's just about to happen, I'm just going to pop over to the oven. Give yourselves a little time, guys. Have a little cup of tea if you need to. I'm going to check on my bread. Remember, I said 15 to 20 minutes for the smaller buns. This is the 15 minute check. Okay, it might need a couple of minutes more. We don't need to worry too much if it's not ready quite yet. Oh, I wish this video came with smell-o-vision, because when you open an oven full of delicious freshly baked bread, it's just a wonderful smell. Now mine is not quite there yet. I'm going to add it in for another 3 minutes. So then we've gone for a full 18. And we don't want to turn the temperature up too much, because if you then put your bread in at too high a temperature, what happens is you'll create a crust on the outside, but your insides won't bake evenly. So that's why 180 gas mark 4 is much better. Now, I said I'm going to show you a little trick here, okay? So I'm going to put a little bit of our baking powder in the bottom of this jug, okay? I'm going to bring you over to a little close-up so you can see what happens. So this bit is where we really talk about food being one of those all-encompassing, topics. This is a little bit of chemistry. We add a little bit of acid to our baking powder, and you can see that actually, see that's foaming up in there? That's what's happening inside our bread when you mix the soda, the baking powder. There we go. Lovely bubbles. When you mix the baking powder with something acidic, like yogurt or our buttermilk, the bubbles get created. And this is actually why it's called soda bread. Okay, so bicarbonate of soda, baking powder, they're very similar. Baking powder has bicarbonate of soda in, plus an acidity regulator. So it has a little kind of powdered lemon juice or powdered vitamin C. Anyway, so they create the bubbles inside, and the bread's almost ready. So hope you guys have enjoyed yourselves so far. Remember, when you are cooking, is to have a little look at your recipes before you get started. It's like checking your map before you set out. you kind of know, right, well, at this point I want to be here and I want to stop. Because if you're in the middle of your cooking and you've misread a step or something, that's when people get flustered. And what I really want you all to do is just enjoy the beautiful simplicity of baking. And soda bread is probably one of the most simple things that you can do to bake something in an oven. Next week, we're going to be working to create a lovely chunky tomato soup. The recipes will be going up on the website after we've done here, okay? So on our chefsandschools.org.uk or hackneyschoolofffood.com. The video that we've done today will be up there with the archive recipe, but you'll also have the new recipe for next week. And I hope you join us again for that. I'm going to grab my breads out of the oven. If yours aren't quite ready yet, guys, don't worry. I'm going to show you what mine look like so that you can have a guide, and then we'll come back, okay? And this is fantastic. So, this is what my bread looks like now. You can see it's puffed up, and as I put it down, this is the bit where you really have to have patience. You can't just dive straight into the bread, even though you want to, okay? You'll see that it's puffed up like this. It's made that lovely cross in the top. There we go. I'll show you the ones with the seeds on top as well. And you can see we've got that lovely golden brown, that lovely toastiness as well. The best way to test if your bread is ready is your first thing, check the color. Golden brown. Business. The next thing is turn it upside down and then give it a tap. I'm going to hold you next to my microphone, so hopefully you'll be able to hear it, but it should sound hollow. That sounds hollow to me. It smells amazing. So what we're doing is using our senses, okay? It looks good, it sounds good, it smells good. When you're leaving bread to cool, don't leave it on the same tray that's just come out of the oven, because what will happen is it creates steam on the bottom. If you've got a cooling rack that has lots of holes in it, that's perfect. If not, guys, just pop it in an area that's slightly cooler, maybe by the window or something. But make sure just take it off the hot tray that you've baked with. But guys, that is how you make a fantastically beautiful veggie-packed soda bread. You can see we've been here 43 minutes, but I've actually been talking for a lot of that, so we've been baking for even less. This is how quick fresh bread is, okay? Our recipe and ingredients are online if you want to do this and watch the video and come back again. But here we go, guys. Look at these beauties. We've got parsnip and seeded loaves. Here we go. We've got my four lovely buns here. I've got my chive butter like that. And because I know I've got hungry chefs to feed, I've got buttermilk from my Cheats buttermilk. You can see it's getting even thickier each time I show you. And also the buttermilk left over from my butter making. I'm going to make some more bread later on. I hope you've enjoyed today, gang. We've had, I've had a lot of fun. This is one of my favorite recipes. It's also one of the reasons why, you know, get into cooking, because you can basically bake this and eat it straight away. Even get to cool down for 5 minutes or so. Fresh butter, beautiful. Just like being back on the farmhouse. Next week, we're going to be doing a chunky tomato soup. Recipes going up onto the website today. If you want to view this video back, we're putting it up on our YouTube channel, Chefs and Schools, and it'll be on the website as well, Hackney School of Food. Thank you so much for joining us today. I hope you have enjoyed cooking. I really would love to see the things that you've created today. So tag us at Hackney School of Food or use the hashtag Cookalong with Chef Tom. Be brilliant to see what you're up to, because this is it, the food, the sharing, seeing what everyone else is made from the same ingredients. Everyone has their own twist and opinion on it. But guys, thank you so much. Happy cooking, and I'll see you next time.